Today I'm going to speak on visiting the past for freedom now. And for some of you, you may think, well, some of these things you're saying, I heard you say this not too long ago. But do you know what? I celebrate Independence Day, memorialize that every year. And the thoughts that came to mind as I prepared my heart to address this body were the same thoughts that came when I first delivered a version of this. Visiting the past for freedom now.
On July 4th, 1776, our founding fathers signed the Declaration of Independence. We know this day as the very first Independence Day. It is now an American holiday associated with food, fun, family, and fireworks. Lots of fireworks. It's a day when we celebrate what's important. It's a day when we celebrate this nation's freedom. It is also a chance for us to focus on another freedom that we have, a freedom given to us not by our founding fathers, but by our Heavenly Father. So as we take time to celebrate our nation's independence and freedom, let's also pause and thank God for our spiritual freedom from sin, shame, and fear. A freedom that has been made possible by Jesus.
It says in Galatians 5, verse 1, that it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm and do not let yourselves be burdened again by the yoke of slavery. This week, our country celebrates Independence Day when on the 4th of July in 1776, the Continental Congress declared that the 13 American colonies would no longer be subject to the oppressive rule of the King of England. But under God, as united colonies, we would live free. And Independence Day is an important day. It's part of our shared history, all of us who live in this country. This is what we have inherited from the labor and the fighting, fought for independence. And it's a shared history that's worth revisiting. And and this particular week, we're going to visit that. I want you to make sure you take some time to think about not only the immediate freedoms we have, but think of the cost that it took for us to procure that freedom, and others paid it and were the beneficiaries of it. On a personal level, we all have a history. And history are the tracks that are left in time. For some, it's been a pleasant walk, one that asks to be revisited. Do you ever turn and look at the mirage of memories of your past? It seems as though it has no bound. As the older people look around and fading eyes open and go, wow, a lot has gone down since those things happened. Sometimes it's a pleasant journey down the path, memory lane. But for others, it's a path to pain. And when they close their eyes, it is not wonderful images that come to mind, but things that they wish they could forget. I'm dealing with someone right now in my life that is struggling, and even in old age, the things that happened long ago are tormenting the person, and to the point where, how do I get these things that have been printed up here out of my mind? The memories are not a pleasant journey for all of us. Today, I want to look at some of the reasons that we visit the past and ask, are these journeys down memory lane profitable or perilous. And some scriptures seem to encourage us to look back and remember, while others seem to discourage that. And how do we deal with this? Well, Isaiah 43, 18 through 19 says, "Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I'm doing a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do not you perceive it? Don't you see it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert." Wow. Even though you're not supposed to dwell on the past in a way that would be destructive to you, going, "Oh, I wish I could go back to the old days." We have to remember that God, who was back then, is here now in the present. And that there is hope. God is doing new things all the time. He is a God of the present, not just the past. In Isaiah 51, verse 1, it says, "Listen to me, you that follow after righteousness, you that seek the Lord. Look to the rock." In other words, remember. "Look to the rock from which you were hewn." Some of you are chip off the old block. Nice to see you there, buddy. They're chip off the old block, right, Jim? "And like a chip off the old block, though you might have ended up been a rolling stone for a while, a rough one." Not buddy, right? No, yeah. It's amazing how God has a way of sort of chipping off of those rough edges, and eventually you come to place, find that you're one of the lively stones that's been placed into the body of Christ that fits perfectly, that redemption. You can be a strong foundation in this body of Christ that you are part of, just like your father, who also started out rough. Can I have an amen from the family? Now, of course, I was perfect the whole time. No, that's, you know better than that.
I do.
Yeah, right. But that wasn't amen pretty loud. Okay. Anyway. Ephesians 2, verse 12 says, "Remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, excluded from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenant of promises, having no hope and without God in this world." That is our state. And I do remember the pit from which I was dug. I remember that, and I sometimes visit that. But there's a difference between remembering or visiting the past and living there. We don't want to go back to the old days. And we don't want to end up wishing we were in the good old days, because God is the God of the now. He was then, but he is present now. You won't find your way forward by focusing on the past. And this is something you can go home with. There is no future in the past. It's very true. Though at times, there are lessons that can be learned by visiting them. The answers that you will find come from acknowledging and owning your past failures, taking responsibility for them, and then reaching to Christ, who can give you the strength to move forward into freedom and receive all that God has for you. Do you know the Apostle Paul? You know, the one who wrote a good portion of the New Testament? He had a past. He had a rough past. He had a past that included killing Christians, hunting a person who was self-righteous to the point of killing his enemies. Love was not his motivation, but an allegiance to law and justice, to the point where he was a dangerous person to the new church that was being found. But the Apostle Paul owned his past. He acknowledged it and he even visited it at times, though he certainly did not live there. In Philippians 3, 13 through 14, it says, "Brothers," this is Paul writing, "Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it on my own. But one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press forward to the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." There's a time to both look back for a moment, and there's a time to forget that which has gone in the past. Ecclesiastes 3 verse 1 says, "There's a time for everything and a season for every activity under the sun." I found that if we follow God, who is the author of history, whose name is I Am, the present one, that's what he calls himself. He is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But he calls himself and wants us to see him as the great I Am, the present one. Abraham is with the Lord in heaven. Jacob, those saints who've gone before, they are still there with the present I Am. And we who are yet alive are here, and the great I Am is here present. We can only walk with him in freedom if we walk with him in the present. We only visit the past at the Holy Spirit's prompting. At times, God will ask you to turn around and go back and go, "Yeah, I used to be this." It's hard to even imagine, but that's what I was. And I believe it's valuable for you to not sugarcoat your testimony and say, and have people believe that you're always as perfect as you are now, right? No. I can see you and you can see me. We're both in works in progress. But the thing is we can't sugarcoat our past. We have to embrace it and own it and say, "That's what I was." And as the Apostle Paul said, "I was one of these people." He understood, but he did not live there. And do you know what? When the Holy Spirit prompts you to give a testimony and you give a little bit of a look back, do it. But don't put a smile on your face as if you're missing that one. All right? Rather, understand how horrific it was to be separated from God because of your actions and your sin. And then quickly move on to point to God, who is your Redeemer, who has given you freedom. So, yes, at times the Holy Spirit will prompt you to visit your past. But make sure that you don't glorify it. You glorify Christ, who is the present one today. John 14, 26. Jesus is speaking and he says, but the helper, he's promising what the I Am, the present one, how he will teach you and instruct you and give you cues as to when you do what and who you should listen to. John 14, 26 says, but the helper, which is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I've said to you. Well, what was it that Jesus taught? Well, in the Great Commission in Matthew 28, verse 20, it says that we're supposed to go into the whole world and preach the gospel. Talk about what Jesus did. Focus on him and teach others, these new disciples, those that would believe the gospel. Teach the new disciples to obey all the commands that I have given you. And be sure of this, Again, he reiterates this, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. Hallelujah. That gives us peace. That even when we're going through difficult times and we go, where is God in all of this? He is right here. He is sovereign and he's king, and he has allowed junk to happen because he has grace and mercy. He has not destroyed this earth yet. He's given us time so that you can share the gospel with those around and you can point to Jesus, who is your hope, no matter whether you're living in India or living in China or in the U.S. God is present and here and with you and giving you life and a hope. God only asks us to go back to remember the promises that he's going to be with us always, and to trust him with our future. A memorial is a place of remembrance. And I think memorials are good in our life. Whether you're when they came out of Egypt and eventually passed into the promised land, they were told to gather rocks from the center of the river, which had been dried up, so that the children of Israel couldn't go into the land. They asked the strong men to go out there, the head of each tribe, and pick up big rocks and bring it out from the bottom of the river and set it on the bank. And they'd pile them up as a marker of remembrance. It's the word Ebenezer. Markers of remembrance are important, whether it be like the Liberty Bell here pictured, which reminds us that we do have a past, that we had to fight for the liberties that we enjoy. But we also need to remember and visit the markers in our life where God has brought you freedom and delivered you, because we have a tendency to forget. In Genesis 28, 10 through 17, it speaks of Jacob when he was being chased by his brother Esau. And let's read this portion of scripture. Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. And when he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. And taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. Well, it doesn't sound like a very comfortable place, because he was on the run. He was really desperate need. He was a man without a country, as it were, being chased by his own brethren. And sometimes I will tell you that it feels like in the country right now that there's so much division that brother and sister are against each other. And you wonder, what country are we living in? What did he do when he was in such a desperate situation where he could only find a rock for a pillow? He put this rock under his head and lay down to sleep. And he had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth and its top reaching to heaven. And the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord. And he said, I am the Lord. Oh, I love it when God says I am, because it reminds me he's always with us. I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac, and I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are living. Let's keep reading. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and the east, to the north and the south. All people on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. And I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go. And I will bring you back to this land, and I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised to you. Then Jacob woke up from his sleep. He thought, surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. Yes, it was a wonderful spot, a place which he would memorialize, calling it Bethel, which means the house of God. But what God said to him was that he would be with him. Not only you, but to your descendants. And certainly we who are the adopted children of Abraham and Jacob, we have been adopted in because of the blood of Jesus. God's covenant promises of his faithfulness, the great I am being with us, is pertinent and applicable to us today. And we should celebrate that. You don't have to go to any place to find the presence of God. Where you are, God is. Well, Bethel actually means house of God. And it was the place where Jacob encountered God. It was where he was comforted and encouraged. But later on in Jacob's life, in Genesis 34, verse 30, again, sin in his life and his family, his descendants that had the opportunity of blessing of God, sin had invaded and they disobeyed God and they had allowed idols to come into their lives. Sobering thought. The consequences of your actions will, in some way, buffer the blessings of God. The blessings of God require that you live in obedience to what he says. So in Genesis 34, verse 30, he's again in a very desperate situation. Then Jacob said to Simeon and Levi, "You have brought trouble on me by making me obnoxious to the Canaanites and the Perizzites and the people living in the land." See, they'd done some very wicked things. And all of a sudden, they were in the target hairs of the people they lived amongst. And Jacob says, "We are few in number, and if they join forces against me and attack me, I and my household will be destroyed." But God told Jacob, "Return to Bethel, where I appeared to you when you were running from your brother Esau, and make your home or live there and build an altar to me." And Jacob said to his family and to everyone else who was traveling with him, because he was on the run, "Get rid of your foreign gods, then make yourselves acceptable to worship God and put on clean clothes." In other words, clean up your act, get rid of your sin. God just told me I'm supposed to go back to Bethel, the place where he visited me in the first place. "And afterwards, we will go to Bethel, and I will build an altar there to God, who answered my prayers when I was in trouble and who has always been at my side." Hallelujah. For some of you, the struggles you're having may be because you've allowed idols to come into your life. Yes, you were saved. You got a testimony. You have a Bethel place. You can remember back, but that's not where you're living. You have wandered quite far. And you're wondering why around you the peace of God is not guarding your hearts and thoughts and minds. And your freedom that you had in Christ is no longer something that you enjoy. But you have to wrestle daily against the attacks of the very same sins and thoughts that had brought you down in the past. And you go, "How in the world did I get to this place?" And God is saying to you today, go back to Bethel. Go back to the place and live there. Get rid of your idols. Follow after me and I will bless you. I have helped you in the past and I will help you again. Stay close and live clean. When I visited in Israel, it altered the images my imagination had painted when I read the scriptures. I had thought it was very different. A land of palm trees and Jesus walking by beautiful, idyllic lakes that only got rough in order for him to have a miracle to calm it. And it was just, you know how these snapshots. I had a flannel graph imagination of Israel, for those of you who can remember flannel graphs. How many can remember a flannel graph? Wow, we got some older ones here. I tell you what, they worked good in Sunday school. I tell you what. But it was not an accurate representation of what I actually saw. In a way, when I was there, we were literally visiting the past, walking the same streets and towns where Jesus did. And I have to say that having been there, the Bible stories now look a little bit different to me, because I know and have felt the stones and the hills, which are so steep. They must have been aerobically in shape to be able to go up and down from, you know, they had walked everywhere. No Ubers there. And it was, they must have been, this was a rough thing. You said you're going to go over to, the city next door. I mean, you better have spent a lot of time on a Peloton to be able to get ready, to be able to do it. I don't know if I could do it. But these, it looks totally different than what I imagined. I've never seen so many rocks and so many ruins. More than once, I have worked with GCF, people from this church. Remember Kathleen? We were working on, and Norm, yep. And a number from church, we went to Israel more than once. And we were working on an archaeological dig called Tel Helmar that, according to Genesis 14, verse 7, was settled more than 4,000 years ago. But it was Tel Mar. And you have to understand what a tell is. A tell is a term that describes a city mound. When a city begins to fall down, its residents knock down the old walls and build on top of the rubble. And over time, the level on which the city is built rises, and this mound is called a tell. When we dug, we discovered actually seven defined periods since the fortress city was first inhabited 4,000 years before. Pretty amazing to dig through that and go, oh, another whole lives went by, generation after generation. Israel is filled with the ruins and tells, all testaments to thriving people groups who, for some reason, failed to survive. And they vanished under the sands of time. Why did that civilization fall? Why did that community be just a pile and a layer underneath a city? Well, I don't know. It could have been famine. It could have been disease or corruption or war. But all these things happen in the world we live in. This is going to continue to happen as long as time marches forward. But I also visited ornate churches, beautiful edifices that are now nothing more than empty tombs, where tourists come and view and wonder what kind of spiritual life once was involved or happened in these tombs they called churches. Why did they fail? Why are they empty? Why are they nothing more than a beautiful monument to something that was? I will tell you, I believe it's because they no longer visited their Bethels. And it's very important that we need to visit the places where God has changed us, in order to motivate us and give us perspective and to stand up again and go, I'm going to march forward. I'm going to follow Jesus because I remember what it was like. But if we just go on and forget the pit from which we were dug, and if we do not visit the past momentarily at crucial times to remember how bad it was, we will also have empty buildings where all it is, wow, that's a nice facility. I wonder what we can do here. Or maybe we'll just have to bulldoze it and build a shopping mall. Or in the, nowadays, an Amazon warehouse. Bethel means house of God, where we encountered God. And it's not a man-made structure, but Bethel is in the hearts of men and women. It's been said that those who do not learn from history are bound to repeat it. I tell you what, I don't want to be a footnote in history. And I don't want this church to be something that people go, oh, I remember it used to be a place where the presence of the Lord was. Because the presence of the Lord can be here now, and it can be here when, if the Lord tarries, your children are here and you're in glory. If we remember that we need to focus on the living, present God and put our idols aside and follow after Him and do what the Holy Spirit says, I don't want to be just a memory in the past. I want to be a marker of what God could do through a simple man or a simple woman like you. Remind yourself often what God has done. What, when God first saved you, how did you feel? When you're in trouble and under attack, and the sky seems like brass, remember those moments when all hope seemed to be gone, and God came through for you and delivered you, and hope went into joy. Remember those in the times you're going through now, that God promised He will be always with you and give you hope and a future. Remember the time you first encountered God. I've had many Bethels in my life, and I visit them often. And do you know when I visit them the most? When I find myself walking around in life and seeing other people's despair. And I try to tell them, because compassion in my heart is, my heart is broken. They're lost. And I want to share with them the way to life. And it's in those moments where I go, oh, that's right. I relate to them. I said, I know what it's like to be alienated and separated from God. And for a moment, I walk down back and time and pick up a few dirty details and bring it to the light of day and say, this is what I used to be. I did that yesterday. I did it not only in the old folks' home of or the retirement home at Sunset Manor, where I had the privilege of spending. I went there for I think an hour, and I was there, left at 2:30. Went all through lunch. Had so much time talking to the older generation. Believe me, there is an older generation than me. There is, but and when I was done packing up my guitar and stuff, there are all these young people sitting around a table, folding napkins, preparing. Those that service and met and take care of those. And I felt the Holy Spirit prompting me to come over. Would you, who serve these people, like to hear a song? Well, yeah, we're just folding silverware. I said, okay, what kind of music you like? And for a moment, I pulled out a guitar and did some really raw stuff that you wouldn't appreciate in this church. And then, whoa, I like that. And then I did Somebody's Praying, which you would appreciate as well as young, that God sees you. And then I sat down at a table next to them as they folded their napkins. And I unfolded my life a little bit of when I was their age and how I was lost. And all I had was religion and how Jesus came and saved me and gave me joy and made my life new. And as I'm doing it, they're folding, but they're looking up, and they're saying where they go to church, and they loaded the app Word Server. You should do it too. It's a way to get information. And we It was such a wonderful time. Tears in their eyes. It was fellowship. They claimed to be Christians, and I believe some of them were. But I encouraged them to stand up and seize their authority in Christ and end up making a difference in their society. And don't worry about canceled. Be strong and go out there. There was visiting the past. But it was in the moment where the great I am was very present. My arms, the same kind of goosebumps that appear right now as I remember how God's word brings life and encouragement to others. Do both. The world wants to hear your story, but point to Jesus in it. I've had many Bethels and I visit them often. Where is your Bethel? Do you need to revisit it? I was struck by the thousands of tourists from all over the world waiting in long lines just to enter into these ancient places that when we were in Israel, that man had encountered God in the past. Some, by visiting these places, were attempting to make contact with him now. Though I found those places interesting, I was not searching for God because I knew him. He had made himself real to me. It's so sad to see people visiting the empty tomb, a grave where Jesus supposedly was laid. To visit an empty grave in their quest for life and find nothing. It's sad. Mary and his disciples knew the sadness when they saw the empty tomb. And it says, it's recorded in Luke 24:5-6. But the angel said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He's not here, for he is risen." It doesn't matter whether you're trying to visit the actual tomb where Jesus' dead body once lay. It only matters whether you have encountered the risen Lord today. That's what matters. Have you had an encounter with Jesus Christ, who is alive today? That will give life. In 1 Peter 1, verse 8 through 9, it says, "Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your soul." Hallelujah. There are many things that I regret in life. I regret, some people say, "I have no regrets." What life did you live? I'm gonna get everybody in this church to raise their hand, all right? And you have an opportunity if you're honest. How many of you ever done anything that you regret? What a glory move. Wow. Take a picture of that, but they won't know what the caption underneath it is, right? I have many things I regret about my past. I cannot change my past, but I have complete peace about my future. Complete peace. I see and visit the ruins of my past the same way I see and view the empty tomb. He is risen and he is alive. I died with Christ. And when I was baptized, they made a very visible representation. It was very tangible. It was almost like a Bethel moment. How many of you had the Bethel moment of being baptized, plunging your old man underneath the watery grave and being raised up in the likeness of Christ's resurrection? Your old man left at the bottom of a dirty lake, all right, or a pool or a hot tub. Doesn't matter. It's the symbolism, that Bethel moment. I visit the ruins of my past the same way I see Jesus' empty tomb. I see an empty tomb which proves that he is alive. In 1 Corinthians 15:54, it says, "When the perishable," that's this body, has been clothed with the imperishable. When we get a new one, hallelujah. The mortal, that's you and I, those that are going to die, and the mortal are clothed with immortality. We will never die again. Then the saying that is written will be true. That which God promised is true. That will be experienced fully. Death has been swallowed up in victory. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17 states our favored position in God. Yes, I revisit my past only to reinforce the freedom that I now live in the moment. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are new. And I challenge you to trust Christ. Put to death your past. Own it and then reject it and receive the salvation that comes from putting your faith in Christ. The answers you seek are not in the past, but it's available here right now. For God, the great I am, is here right now. And I want you all to stand up because I'm going to give an invitation. I want every head bowed. This might be an Independence Day for you, an opportunity for you to make a change in your history and all the regrets because of the idols that you've been holding on to and all the things that the sin that easily besets you, which would keep you from heaven. Lay that aside and receive the mercy and forgiveness that Christ's blood has provided for those that put their faith in him. So if everyone's head is bowed, if you would like to make a statement right now and say, I want to be new. I want to put my faith in Christ. I want you to put your hand up. Now I challenge you with your head still bowed. If you need to visit your Bethel again because of the struggles that have been happening, the Holy Spirit has said, you got to visit your Bethels. You put your hand up and you know the Holy Spirit's talking to you. Put your hand up. Let's see of those who feel that. Okay. I pray in the name of Jesus that your spirit, which is present right now, would draw them back to a place of the simple beginning of childlike faith in you. I pray, God, that the peace that you promise to those who put their trust in you would flood over them beyond their understanding. They can't get rid of their past, but they can get it washed away and covered by the blood of Jesus, and they can be made new. I pray that the infilling of the Holy Spirit that is offered to all who believe would flood into their hearts as they say, fill me, God. I yield to you. I want to know you in a new way. I want to have joy in the morning and joy that is infectious. I pray the Lord bless you and keep you, and may the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and give you his peace. At this point, you can end up going and enjoy your Independence Day, but be dependent on Christ.
I hope you've enjoyed this. To hear other messages by Calvin Bergsma, go to facebook.com/GCF Church or youtube.com/GCF Church.
You may also follow Georgetown Christian Fellowship with our app. Go to either iOS or the Play Store for Android and search for Word Server. That's one word, Word Server, and install the free application. There you will get all of our messages, including streaming capabilities.